When I was a kid, I learned how to make Kievs by watching my dad in the kitchen of his pub. So I've asked him over to help me show you how to do my version of this 80s classic.
Me and my dad, we're going to cook it up. We love chicken Kiev. When I was about 5 or 6, I remember you making hundreds of these a week in the pub.
You used to help me.
Customers went crazy for it. We're bringing it back, we're giving it love, but also we're putting a few little twists on it as well. And I think actually, before we even get onto the chicken, it's all about the garlic butter, which is a brilliant thing to learn. Dad taught me how to do it back in the day, but I want to take it onto the next level. My little twist at the beginning is smoked bacon. And as you know, in life, if you want it to get a little bit better, a bit of smoked bacon does that.
Fry 6 rashers on a medium heat until they turn crisp. The bacon will add a wonderful smoky flavour to the garlic butter.
I love the smell of bacon.
And will give my chicken Kievs a surprise crunch in the middle.
So, Dad, you like to chop some parsley for me?
Yeah, sure.
Whenever you're making garlic butter, I think it's always worth doing a big batch and freezing any that you don't use. So I'm making this with 2 whole packs of butter. Chop up half a bunch of parsley and as much garlic as you fancy. I'm using a whole bulb.
Dad, can I just borrow that knife for a second? We're sharing, it's like the old times, sharing. I'll take this end off. What's beautiful, if you get the chance to grow some garlic, please have a go, because actually, if I just take that off, I think people don't realise that when you grow your own garlic, you don't just get that kind of dried up bit like this, you get this whole bit. Mm. So actually, I'm just gonna finely slice this part here. Shall I jump on this? I might as well, while I'm here. So Dad, if you can just turn that bacon for me. One of the things I'm gonna do just to lighten it is a lovely unwaxed lemon. Just a little rub of zest makes a phenomenal difference.
And lemon always lifts chicken anyway, doesn't it?
It really does. So, parsley and garlic goes in. I've got another little tweak, cayenne pepper. And cayenne pepper was really popular in the 80s, wasn't it?
Yes.
We used to put it on prawn cocktails and all those.
Cocktails, egg mayonnaise, that type of thing.
Yeah, so a nice little pinch, just to give it a little kick up the backside.
Season, then get the bacon ready to go in too, by chopping it up finely. Add the little crispy bits of bacon to your butter, and then mash it all together.
This butter will be good on meat, fish.
Yeah, a nice steak, even a Sunday roast chicken. You could put some butter in between the skin and the meat.
Brilliant, yeah.
And that would just give it a little twist.
Yeah.
Once the butter's combined, it's just got to be rolled up like a sausage.
So, Dad, you show them how you showed me when I was, like, 8 years old.
Oh, what, the roll. Right, OK.
I used to like it because it reminded me of a Christmas cracker.
Yeah.
And then you get your old man to get one end.
And then you
and
just...
I get the other end.
And then you just sort of... just shape it.
Pop that in the fridge for an hour, just to firm up. So, look, I actually did one before Dad got here. And you can see, after all these years, pretty much the same. You taught me well, Dad.
This garlic butter's been chilling for a while, so it's ready for slicing.
Look into the heart of that butter. You can see all the herbs and the lovely bacon. It's a really nice flavoured butter.
You want 2 thin pieces for each Kiev.
Now I can roll this up, put it in the freezer for 1 year, 6 months, happy days.
Next, the chicken breasts.
The thing I'm pleased about is that you've left that little piece of bone on, because you finish your chicken and that's always lovely to nibble on at the end.
Yeah, the nice meat is around the bone. And often if you buy the chicken breast from the butchers, they'll leave the bone on and it's called a supreme. In the supermarket, they normally lob it off. It doesn't matter if you do one or the other, but like Dad said, it looks a bit more premium and you've got a bit more nibblage. So guys, let me show you how to do this chicken. Here we've got a breast. That is the kind of skin side facing up. So nice and shiny. What I want you to do is turn it on its back, like that. And when you do turn it on its back, you'll notice there's a little fillet here. So we're gonna get that fillet, it's still attached, and we're just gonna pull that back like that, okay? And then what we wanna do is a little process to create a pocket. You get the tip of your knife, and you put it into the thick part of the breast, and you just run your knife down, and that is basically it. You can see I've just got the flavoured butter in my hand, and that pocket that I've made, I'm now gonna jab that butter in. So can you see what I've done there? I've covered it up, and then we go back over with the chicken and back over with the fillet, and then we can turn it over, and we've got plump, stuffed, gorgeous chicken breast. Two lovely breasts by two lovely boys. So look, the next stage, I'm not even going to tell Dad what to do. He knows what to do. And this is a preparation that we would have learnt at college called pané, which is a French preparation for breadcrumbing. So flour kind of will stick to the outside of any meat or fish. And then the second stage is the egg. A little bit of salt and pepper. Breadcrumbs as well. I wouldn't buy breadcrumbs. Just use your old stale bread.
Yeah.
We're going to go in with the chicken breast and the flour. Then I will pass it to Dad, and he will do the egg. And often in kitchens, you'd have a line of chefs doing one part of it. You generally wouldn't do it all yourself, because if I go from flour to egg to breadcrumbs, then you end up with panade fingers. So then Dad will put it into that plate. But by the time he's done that, I've come around here, and I do this. Just have a look at it, make sure there's no areas that haven't had their breadcrumbs stick to them, and then we're good to go. Thank you, Daddy. Okay, so cooking the chicken Kyiv, you know, you can do it all in the oven. You can do it all in the deep fat fryer. Some people start them in a pan, like I'm going to, and then finish it in the oven. That way you get a really nice crumb and also a nice bake as well, which is good. So I'm gonna just grab a little sunflower oil. I'm gonna put it in my baking pan. So we're shallow frying, basically. What I do, just to get a gauge on how hot it is, just take a piece of rosemary. When that starts to fry, you get a nice knowledge that it's kind of that frying temperature. So we'll just keep our ears open for that, and it will flavour the oil as well.
To go with my chicken, there's nothing I like more than a bit of mash made with Maris Piper potatoes. But this time I'm adding an extra ingredient.
Broccoli. Broccoli mashed potato. Delicious, beautiful colour. It really works well with chicken. Now here I've got a pan of boiling water. I'm going to chuck these potatoes in, take these little florets off, the flowers, and this. So many times chefs and people at home throw this away. Take the stalk off, slice it up into chunks, put those in with the potatoes, and we'll boil these for about sort of 10 minutes, and then for the last 5 minutes, then I go in with this, and that'll keep its colour, because the flowers don't take as long to cook as the stalks.
I'm now ready for the first stage of cooking my chicken.
So as you can see, a little bit of rosemary in here has told us the oil's ready and raring to go. I'm going to go that shiny side of the breast down first, because that's our presentation side. Always put stuff in oil and just plop it away from you. So I'm just going to fry that for literally 2 minutes on each side. Let's have a look at this chicken. I've got a good vibe about this. Oh! So look, we've got some nice colour on this chicken. The chicken's about half cooked. It'll go in the oven now for about 10 minutes at 180 degrees Celsius, which is 350 Fahrenheit. It's a perfect time now to go in with the florets.
When the potatoes and broccoli are cooked, drain and leave them to steam dry. Then add a knob of butter and get mashing.
You get a wonderful colour out of the broccoli. I'll have a little taste. Season it nicely. So, Dad, if you may, grab that tea towel. And bring out the Kyiv.
Here we go.
Let's have a little look. This one's exploded, this one hasn't. The smell is phenomenal. So what I'll do, Dad, I'll show you how I like to serve it up. A nice big pile of this gorgeous broccoli and potato mash. And I'm just gonna make a rough old pile of that. We might have to do a bit of running tonight, though. Oh, look at that.
Oh, look at that.
Oh, yes. I quite like a little simple spinach salad with this. And just lemon juice on there, so it's got real cut and attack.
Also, the lemon will lift the chicken.
Oh, it really, really will. You know, a few bits in and around, like this. A little wedge of lemon just to squeeze on top.
I love the simplicity of it. There it is.
Gorgeous. And that, my friends, is a great, great pub classic. OK, Dad, we've got that really hard bit to do now.
The bit that I've been looking forward to.
Should we go outside and eat it?
Yeah, let's.
So good.
It's really good.
You get the crunch of the crunch on the outside, and then you get the crunch on the inside again.
Yeah, I like the bacon in there, and the lemon is coming through. You even beat me at my own dishes.
I'm not sure. I've got the bone. I can have a little gnaw on.
Go on. I'll keep that for last.
Will you put this on the specials board, Dad?
I will. I'm going back to do it now.
Are you? I'm going to be giving to you a fail-safe barbecued sauce recipe. It works every single time. It's good on pork, it's good on chicken. You're going to love it. I'm going to cook it with really humble chicken drumsticks and chicken thighs. We need 200 grams of sugar, 200 grams of ketchup, 4 tablespoons of Worcestershire sauce. Then we're going to go in some chipotle Tabasco. Woo! English mustard, 2 heaped teaspoons, the juice of 2 oranges, 200 mils of apple juice, and then bourbon. 100 mils, the alcohol's gonna disappear, so don't worry, it's not an alcoholic barbecue sauce, but it's gonna give amazing flavor. And then about 4 tablespoons of balsamic vinegar. We'll season it with a little salt. Get that on a high heat, whisk it up. We're gonna bring it to the boil and simmer it for about 5 to 10 minutes until it's a nice, sticky, claggy, coat the back of a spoon texture. Right, and that's what we want. It's a glaze, okay? So here I've got my lovely free-range chicken. Let's create a rub. For me, the point of a rub is to begin the story. It's kind of that depth of flavor. So fennel seeds, 2 heaped teaspoons of that, 1 level teaspoon of cumin, 1 heaped teaspoon of smoked paprika. Smells incredible. About 1 teaspoon of sea salt, pepper, 1 heaped tablespoon of lovely golden caster sugar, and give it a good old bash up. Hello! This is Daddy's office. Look, there's a cameraman. Say hello. I feel the same way about him often as well. Okay, buds, we're making a rub. Watch, Daddy. Well done, buds. That's lovely. He's gonna be a chef one day, I can feel it. Can you shake that over for me, darling?
Can't.
Can you do it that way? That's it, onto that chicken. Onto the, over here. That's good. That's it. That's, yep, yeah, throw the pestle and mortar on it. That's exactly what I asked for. Can I have a kiss? I love you, you're a good boy. So I'm just gonna rub the rub over the chicken. So son, now I'm gonna put it in the oven for about 1 hour at 180 degrees Celsius, which is 350 degrees Fahrenheit. Here's one I made earlier. You can see the chicken's been nicely cooked. Just take the thigh and completely submerge it into our barbecue sauce to get that perfect glaze on your perfect chicken. What we do now is we put this back in the oven, and I'm gonna turn the oven down to about 100. I'll just leave that for like maybe 10, 20 minutes. Of course, we know the best barbecued ribs and chicken and barbecue sauce, it happens outside over fire. In England, it's raining a lot. So I've got some wood chips here, apple oak. We just set it on fire here. It gives you an amazing smoke. So it's like a little mini smoker. That'll just slowly smolder. And it's just a really cool way of getting extra flavor into your food. What you could do is after about 10 minutes, you can do a double dip to get double glaze.
Our home smoker is working very, very well. So, 20 minutes has passed. Have a little look at this, guys. We got the rub, the slow cooking, the double dip in the beautiful barbecue sauce. Really, really good. What is this?
Chili.
Yes. And does Buddy like chili? Why don't you like chili?
It's too hot.
Now, I'm going to give you the one without chili on. Okay? That's the bone. Take that bit there. Take that bit there.
Daddy.
Yeah? It's too sticky?
No. It's still too hot.
You mean spicy? Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was smoked paprika in there that I didn't tell you about. I wasn't thinking that you'd notice.
Did you tell me?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I should have told you.
Is
this bad parenting?
I think.
Yeah. Maybe not for young kids at 3 and a half, admittedly, but for big boys and girls around the world, yes. Absolutely delicious. So there you go, guys. That's my fail-safe barbecue sauce recipe. I hope you enjoyed it. From me and Buddy, bye-bye. Say bye-bye, son. That's what I thought. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Just try and be professional. We're going to take four, okay?
Take four.
Okay, son. So now's the time to put this in the oven. Don't say again. They will think that we don't do TV shows in one take. So, son, this goes in the oven.
I know that, you poo-poo snack.
This is all going wrong. Okay.
Say the wrong thing.
Okay, yeah, I know, thanks. What, are you my agent?
No!
Okay, are you ready? Say take 20.
20 is too much.
Okay. Take 15?
Yes.
You are the best.
Daddy, you're rubbish.
That's about right. Right, you lovely lot, we want to get some veggies in, and a chopped salad is a very, very cool, delicious way to do that. Buddy's going to show you how to do it. We've got the more predictable salad leaves here, you know, anything you've got. We've got a bit of watercress, a bit of gem, romaine, but also you can get things like broccoli in there as well. So, Bud, show them the cross-chopping method. Just keep chopping, chop, 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 chopping, and swooping up, that's it. The reason that this is a brilliant chopping method is it's very safe. Right, and Buddy's been doing this for many, many years. Both hands are out the way of the blade. One's at the end of the blade to support it. Fingers out, not crossed. And then you've got one on the handle. And we love a chopped salad, don't we, Jay?
Yeah, the kids love it, actually.
We can dress it up with like French dressing, balsamic dressing, like a yogurt dressing. And River, you love salad, don't you?
No, I don't.
He really doesn't. Show him what you do next, Bud.
So you make a well in the middle.
Okay. This is the important bit, guys.
And you get a teaspoon of mustard.
Yeah, so that's French mustard. You could use English. That's probably enough, my friend. So you want about a tablespoon of balsamic vinegar. Buddy, River, stop shouting. We're trying to make a cooking show. Then you want about 2 tablespoons of nice extra virgin olive oil. So then you just mix it all together and keep on chopping. And then what Bud is going to show you is you just kind of get the knife under and just sort of put it back on top. So you're almost like dressing and chopping the dressing into it. And that is, my friend, the chopped salad. Pops, let's do you first, darling. Okay, Daisy's coming up first. Bit of lemon. It's now time to eat. Guys, did you like that? We're all so used to shopping in supermarkets these days that we forget what's actually on our doorstep. Stinger nettles might sound a bit of a weird ingredient, but they're actually packed full of vitamins and they're nothing to be afraid of. They've been used in food and cooking for millennia. Try and go for the nice top new growth leaves, the smaller ones, they're sweeter. And then you can braise them down, steam them, boil them. I use them in soups, minestrones. You can put them in stews at the last minute. You can do amazing bean dishes with these beautiful things. You can braise them down with garlic and onions, marjoram, and make the most delicious, silky smooth pasta sauces, or put it into a risotto, or braise it down and sprinkle it over a pizza or a quiche. Come on. So these under loves little greens, let's give them some love. And next time you go for a walk, maybe, maybe there's a dish for you. Just give them a good wash. And once you've added a few extra ingredients, they really make a tasty ravioli filling.
All that needs now is some pasta.
Okay, should we have some fun?
Yeah.
You need to crack it in the middle of the flour. Oh. Right, go like this. Get this. One, two, then you pull it open. There you go.
Now mix it. In.
Now, what you can do is you go around the outside and you bring it in. But you do it slowly in the middle and then you slowly go around the outside.
In the flour?
A little bit. Now I might add a little bit of water. Mix that in. You just try and get it nice and smooth.
Yeah.
And then you start moving in the flour now.
Yeah.
And then we start using our hands. Can we pull your, little things up like that?
Oh, the flour in.
Just move it. Do you not want to do it anymore? Come and have a look, Riv.
Dad is lasagna.
Yeah, it's sort of like lasagna. Here we are. Take your hands off. Don't touch anything. Now we turn them into like little presents. This little thing here. Let Daddy do the first one because these are very fragile.
And these are very delicate.
Can I do some as well?
Kiss. Right, watch Daddy and concentrate for once. You go here and you push through. Raviolis are very, very fragile.
And they're very nice to eat, so
yogurt and some ripe bananas. So first of all, I'm going to show you how to freeze the bananas. So what you're going to do is you're going to peel them.
Oh my god.
There you go. And then we're going to chop them.
That's it, yeah.
Whenever you're using a knife, make sure there's always an adult. I've got a great little tip. When you use a lime,
which Petra's going to get now.
Yeah, so the acid from the lime stops the banana from going brown and it also adds a lot more flavour. So we're going to cut this in half using the bridge method. Two fingers on the side of the lime and then just cut straight down and then it's in half. And then you can just squeeze it right over the banana. Then we're going to just...
Nothing's coming out.
There's no juice there.
It's a challenging job. So you're going to toss the bananas in the lime juice so all of the bananas
get all the juice.
Get all the juice in it. And then you're going to get one of these bags that Petal has right here. You're going to put these bananas into the bag, and then you're going to freeze them for about half a day, and they'll turn very hard. And then you can keep them in for there for about a month.
Right, let's make some ice cream.
So we've got the frozen bananas here, ready frozen bananas, and we'll open this up if I can.
Isn't everybody?
I thought you said it was 1 minute ice cream.
So these are the frozen bananas, and then we're just going to pop them into the food processor. Processor. So we're going to whiz it up.
Be careful with your hands.
Take this off.
Grab a spatula.
There you go. So you're going to go around the edges to get all the stuff in the middle, and then you're going to put the top back on and give it another buzz. Oh, it looks so good. All you need is 3 big tablespoons of yogurt. Right, look at that. We're going to use a spatula again to mix it up.
I got the cone.
So we're going to use the spoon that we use for the yogurt, and we're going to get a cone. And we're just gonna fill it up with ice cream.
And remember to do this quickly before it melts.
Yep. Nice.
This one?
Thank you.
I'm not a very good scooper, am I?
No. Now we can add some sprinkles and decoration. There you go.
Yum.
Messy is good. And then we have a trick here with the chocolate. We get a grater and we can just use one of these sides. I don't really know which one, but I'm going to use this one. Grate that. Yeah, you need adult supervision to do this.
Don't grate your hands.
It's quite dangerous. And just, yeah, be rushing here. And then what you're going to do, we can add some cinnamon on the top from the height. Ooh. And we've done our ice cream of wonders.
Rilla! Ice cream!
Now we can eat. I'm hungry.
I'm making hungry.
Hey, River.
Chocolate.
River, there's your ice cream.
Dad, that's so big!
So there you go, guys. That's our 1 minute ice cream. Do it quickly so it doesn't melt.
Pookie, dookie.